You go to the doctor, right? Doctor will give you a sleeping pill. Now, where does this sleeping pill work? Where does it work, ma? It works in the brain, but mind is not in the brain. Sleep is not because of the brain, because of the mind. What is the difference between mind and brain? You must be thinking, what is this fellow talking about? He must have gone off his bonkers. What is he talking about? Mind is not in the brain. Where else can it be? It is in the leg. 40 years ago, I wrote a book, Wisdom of the Human Body. I wrote there, mind is not in the brain. The publisher, who has a PhD in physics, he called me and said, sir, do you know what you have written? I said, yes, I know what I have written. Sir, you are the dean of a medical college and you are writing, mind is not in the brain. I said, yes, it is not in the brain. Can I publish it? If you want to publish it, you don't want to publish it, don't publish it. His name was K.H. Ranganath. He was a brilliant man. He retired as a director general of All India Radio and became the head of the publishing department of Bharati Vidya Bhavan. But he said, Nimma hesaralli martene, maadi. And that book is out of print now. It's crazy. It's a lot of people want the book. Now what's happening here? We believed in the Western science, which said there was a scientist called Wilder Penfield, a neurologist, a neurosurgeon, who got the Nobel Prize for saying that mind is in the brain because I can stimulate the brain and make the body move. Yes, because it's a connection, that's all. You tickle something, leg moves. And the brain gets diseased, leg doesn't move. That's all the difference. But the mind is there. Where is the mind? Consciousness. What a beautiful concept. Do you know where it came from? The Sanatana Dharma, Gochara, Gochara. See, Sanskrit is a fantastic language. Gochara means Gochara, where the cow walks. The road where the cow walks is called Gochara. Gochara, awareness. Gochara, consciousness. Fascinating. So all this came from the Sanatana Dharma. The same Penfield who wrote that the mind is in the brain, before he died, a very few minutes before he died, he had made a statement saying that, I'm sorry, I made a wrong statement saying that the mind is in the brain. Mind is not in the brain and mind is outside the brain. Mind, with its millions, billions of neurons and trillions of synapses, cannot even think of a thought. So consciousness is the canvas on which your thoughts are projected. Just see this thought. Science cannot understand it because science cannot measure it. Marie Curie says science is measurement, measurement is science. So did you love your husband? Huh? Can somebody measure that in science? So you don't love your husband. I always say jokingly, a nice good man is one who marries the girl he loves. But a better man is one who loves the girl he marries. That is the Eastern custom. Somebody asked me when I was a young doctor in England. He said, you hadn't seen your wife before you got married? I said, no. I mean, how do you, oh my God, how do you do that? So I was completely floored. You know, they want the argument. So I asked him, can I ask you a question, sir? Yes. Did you know your child before it became your child? He said, no. Then do you love your child? Then he didn't talk. See, you must be able to tell them exactly what they think about. So, love is something nobody can measure, right? You love your mother, do you? Can you measure that? Unscientific, unscientific. All this is in beyond science, in the conventional sense of the word. But the real sense of the word, what is science? Tell me, what is science? Define science. I know how the books define. Measurement is science, science is measurement. Then John von Neumann said, science is making models, which are mathematical constructs, which with verbal jargon are supposed to work. All this is rubbish. Science is simple curiosity, trying to understand this universe. That's called science. How does this universe work? How does it go on? Why does it go on? This is science. I'll tell you, our Western science is so rubbish. When I was a young cardiologist, one day when a patient was brought to our hospital at 2 o'clock in the morning, dead. He was just 32 years old, married 2 years before, and no children. And this man was so fit. Every day he is playing tennis, he's running, he's eating hardly anything except grass, and he's having checkup every 3 months with the doctor, and here he is dead, dropped down dead. So my boys called me and said, sir, His wife is making a lot of noise here. He was brought dead, but she thinks he is alive. So please come. So it was 2 o'clock in the morning. So I went. I didn't put on my shoe. I had a chappal on. So I went there. She was rolling on the floor. She caught hold of my leg like that. So tight it was. And she asked me one question. I completely changed after that. She said, "Why did my husband die, doctor?" Did you understand that? She didn't say, "How did my husband die, doctor?" I would have given her a big lecture in the class. He had a heart attack, which has got 284. He ate cholesterol, blah, 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 blah. All bullshit. But I would have given that. But she asked a different question. Why my husband, doctor? You see, according to our books, bullshit. He had no business to die at 32. He was absolutely healthy. Regular checkup with the doctor. He had a checkup ECG only 1 month ago, she says. Now then I found out for the first time that I am a bloody fool. I have not been able to answer this silly question. I was so proud. I got this degree, that degree, all nothing. But that day I changed. Then I went a lot of research. I went into Sanatana Dharma. I went into this. I went into religion, teleology, philosophy, all kinds of rubbish. And there I found one scientist telling in 1844, Charles Sherrington, who was a Nobel laureate, saying that positive sciences of the West cannot answer the question why. They can at best answer the question how or how much, but not why. Ratio re is therefore not reason why. Then I realized, as a doctor I can say, how does the heart contract? Can I say, why does the heart contract? But you can say that if you know our ancient wisdom. We say your heart contracts to keep your blood flowing. And then what happens? Why does the blood flow? Very interesting. Narayan Suktani. Narayan Suktani is Dasa Suktani. You know, 10 methods of propitiating God. There are puja methods. And Narayan Suktani is one of the oldest. Thousands of years old. Where there's a beautiful chapter which describes the heart. So beautifully. And it says heart is like a lotus bud kept upside down with its tip slightly to the left. At the root starts a huge stalk which supplies God's energy to all parts of the world, all parts of the body. And it's called Hridaya. Hri means suck. Da means give. Now modern Western science did not know up until recently, to be very precise, 1999, that we didn't know blood is sucked into the heart. We thought blood flows into the heart. No, blood is sucked into the heart. We only knew heart pumps blood. Heart doesn't pump blood. If the heart were to pump blood, the heart will die with one kick. It requires 142 horsepower because you've got 8 lakhs kilometers of capillaries all over your body. And those capillaries are so small, even an RBC cannot go through it. So you can't push it. So heart doesn't pump blood. It only twists the blood and gives it whirling. And whirling is like Katrina or whatever, no? Whirlwind. It collects energy as it grows. So all this comes from ancient wisdom. So do not have a very bad opinion about ancient wisdom. If you talk about ancient wisdom, they say, oh, you're all superstition. You're Rahu Kala. What is this? Man doesn't know the science behind Rahu Kala. Time was when the Maharajas and the Rajas were so powerful that they wanted to build whatever they wanted to build using free labor. No labor laws those days. So the labor had to work 24 hours of the day, 365 days of work, and they would die. Building the China's Great Wall, 3 million people died. Building each one of these huge stupas, etc., thousands have died. So there were some wise people, like this teacher, who had the ear of the king. They said, Rahu Kala is very bad, so 1.5 hours they should not work, the structure will not be very strong. So at least 1.5 hours he can shit, he can piss, he can eat something. So they said it's different times on different days. Mother saw father wearing the turban suddenly. So Monday it is 7:30 to 9. Tuesday it is 3 to 4:30. So that man got some. Then you have, you know, this old idea of fasting on Amavasya. Ekadashi, Dwadashi, Trayodashi, everything you fast. Now we know science says fasting intermittently is very good for health. One of the best things that happened to man is fasting. But every day you eat, we overeat. And we fast one day, your health will improve. All this came from our Sanatana Dharma. I still remember another superstition. People used to come to us and say, "Doctor, I have not got cold for 1 year." I said, "Very good. I wish I didn't get cold for 1 year. It's a horrible thing." "No, sir. I want to get cold. Please get me cold." I said, "Why? If you don't get cold, you'll go mad." Now, when I was young, I was a bloody fool. I used to think he is mad. But today I know how it came. There's a study done in Kolinska Institute in Europe, where mental patients before the drugs were locked up in the hospital for 40-50 years. You know, the real schizophrenics, maniac depressives were locked up. And what they observed was, in these 50 years, this man never even had a common cold. So the connection was reversed, that's all. If you are mad and don't know where you are and who you are, your mind is not on your body, so you don't get any disease. So they didn't. So it was reversed by our observational science that, okay, he was mad because he didn't get cold. No, he didn't get cold because he was mad. But this fellow thought he is becoming mad if he gets cold. You see the difference? That's all. Like, for example, I know a lot of these Brahmins. Have you seen them eating with the, what is that called? Huh? Correct. Now you think it is a superstition? No. It's high science. There's a tube here called the esophagus, which takes food from the mouth to the stomach, which is a closed tube, potentially open, but closed. And if you take solid food first time and swallow it, many of them even choke and die. But if you put a little water, that peristalsis starts, like the snake. So these people were told, little water you drink before eating, otherwise you will die. Who will listen? Then they brought God. God means fear, no? Devara bhayave jnana dharamba. They brought God and said, if you don't do that, God will be angry. So compliance from zero came to 90. So they saved people. See, it's all science. So don't laugh at anything. Think of that. I will again repeat this. My time is up. A fool thinks he is wise. A wise man knows he is a fool. And you are a teacher when you think and know that you are an ignoramus. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I'm sure the participants are a degree more wise now than they were before the session. And I'm sure they will carry this message when they go back to their classes. I now request Swami Jitakamanandaji to present a memento to Dr. B.M. Hegde.